Now, with Liverpool in Rome tomorrow night, I'm delighted to say that we have Oliver Kay on, the chief football correspondent with The Times. And also, last time Oliver was on, or certainly one of the last times he was on, he was talking about his brilliant book as well, Forever Young, the story of Adrian Doherty, football's lost genius, which is well worth a read if you haven't done so already. Adrian Doherty being something of a prodigy and a very interesting character at Manchester United around the same time the class in 92 was making its way through the ranks. But Oliver, and you're very welcome. That is not why we have you on this evening. You wrote a fantastic piece last week in the build-up to the first leg at Anfield about Agostino di Bartolomei, who I was not familiar with. And, well, it's fitting that we talk about him this week because he was, and if you go into Google Images, you'll see the picture of him shaking hands with Graeme Souness pre-match. He was the Roma captain on that evening when Liverpool won their third European Cup in 4 years in 1984.
Yeah, it's I think it was, what was it, the fourth in 8 years, wasn't it? Fourth in 8 seasons, fourth in 7 years. He was Roma's captain in 1984. The reason for writing about him was because, well, it's a little-known story. I'm sure it's very, very well-known in Italy, but, I mean, the number of people who responded to me since the article saying, God, I had absolutely no idea about that was, the reason being, he, as well as being Roma's captain that night, obviously Roma lost on penalties, Liverpool won on penalties, and 10 years later, to the day, he took his life, which is just awful, tragic. And it's this sort of remarkably sad story of this figure who seemed to be revered, not just in Rome, but in Italian football as this sort of bastion of manhood and of a sort of particularly intelligent, resolute kind of leader as Roma's captain of a very good team. And he took his life precisely 10 years later. And so I was just telling that story and my hunch was that, when the draw was made for the semi-finals, my hunch was that people would not know this story and would be interested by it. I think that's been the case. Really, it seems to have been made people certainly been a different dimension to the to those sort of 1984 flashbacks.
Yeah, it certainly struck us. So let's parse our way through his story and bring people from his footballing days through to that terrible night on May 30th, 1994. So you talked about his leadership. He was the, you say in your piece in the Times, he was the Italian football archetype in his play. He was that centre-half or deep-line midfield type player. And he was a real leader. He was Il Capitano. He took Roma to their first Serie A in 41 years in 1983. So when you think about that, a first Serie A in 41 years for the city of Rome, or certainly for Roma fans anyway, he was revered, to say the least. He was a hero.
Yeah, absolute hero. And even in those days, they had Bruno Conti and Francesco Graziani, who were part of the Italian World Cup winning team from 2 years earlier. They also had Falcao and Toninho Cerezo, who were two members of the Brazil World Cup team. I mean, it was a star-studded team, really. But he was the one who, as captain, and I think he played in central midfield that night against Liverpool. I mean, he was the fans' hero, really, and the guy that was basically a sort of standard bearer for not just for the fans but for his teammates. So that he was clearly speaking to people and speaking to Mark Hatley, who played with him in Milan years later, but also to journalists in Italy. I mean, they say he was just this guy who was everybody looked up to, and there's a sort of captain, leader, legend motif that John Terry, for example, went by at Chelsea, and Stephen Gerrard similar at Liverpool, and he seemed to be that type of figure, that the figurhead of the club, not just somebody who wore the armband, but somebody who, despite never actually playing for the Italian senior team, was a real figurehead and a real leader.
An interesting character, a thoughtful character. You included in your piece that when Roma did win that league title in 83, and you can imagine the pandemonium and the celebrations, that Di Bartolomei wrote a letter to the fans in which, as well as acknowledging the success and the happiness as well, urged them not to get too carried away with excessive celebrations. Not everyone wants to be disturbed. What a thoughtful thing to include. And you mentioned as well, he was asked, as I guess footballers are from time to time, you know, to name your idol. His idol was not some footballer.
No, it was Giorgio Di Chirico, I think the name was, an Italian sort of surrealist artist. So, yes, not your typical footballer. But, you know, he said that message for, you know, to the fans after the title triumph, I think it was something about, you know, we mustn't fall into the trap of provincialism by celebrating too much. I mean, it probably sounded, you know, slightly dour in a way, probably, you know, that sort of Roy Keane like joylessness in some ways, but you know, but people were saying, people said to me that he was a, you know, he was just deadly serious about football, about the business of winning matches, and about life. I mean, although he you know, that you could mistake him for somebody who was dour, but he was just somebody who was, you know, ultra professional in a way he viewed football and the way he viewed it on the pitch and away from the pitch. And but, you know, he just felt that, yes, let's celebrate, but let's not go over the top. And
yeah,
well, I think they've won the league title once since then, and it's, you know, you probably should celebrate those days. You probably should go wild, whether it's All Ireland final, or whether it's a Scudetto, or the Champions League, or whatever. But it's he was adamant I shouldn't fall into the trap of provincialism.
Yeah, so and not your standard character. I mean, we all know the Liverpool side of the story in '84, you know, and the pre-match stuff, I think, has been well told, especially over the last week or so from Chris Ray and Souness leading around the pitch and everything else like that. Stevie Nicol famously missed his first penalty. Di Bartolomei scored Roma's first, but then there was the Bruce Grobbler spaghetti legs, and we know what happened. The interesting thing, Oliver, is he was sold to Milan following that cup final.
Yeah, he was, I have to think, was he 28 or 29? He was late 20s, and he was still felt to be in his prime, but he was sold. Nils Liedholm, who'd been Roma's coach, was replaced and went to AC Milan. Sven-Göran Eriksson was actually the coach who was coming in, another Swede who came in at Roma, and it quickly became apparent that he wasn't going to figure in Eriksson's plans. And that Liedholm would want to take him to Milan. So he went to Milan. He had three seasons there, and it was a fairly star-studded Milan team. And he was next to Ray Wilkins and Franco Baresi and Costa Curta, I think, was Costa Curta,
yeah,
or Tassotti perhaps. Yeah. Galli, the goalkeeper, Mark Hatley, who was probably a fairly obscure signing at the time, following another obscure signing the previous summer, which was Luther Brissett. But it was a time when Milan were, you know, recovering from the scandal of one relegation and the embarrassment of another in the mid-80s. Mm. It was before the Dutch influx of Rijkaard, Van Basten, Hullit. And it was this sort of in-between Milan team. That,
okay.
And he was apparently a very respected, influential member of that team. And when I spoke to Mark Hatley about him, he was raving about him, you know, just, you know, saying, you know, he would sometimes play in the central defence with Baresi sweeping, but he would normally play in midfield with Ray Wilkins, and he would just, you know, spray these passes around, sit in front of the backboard for spray passes around, like, you know, probably like the Pirlo role as we've come to know in later years. But he said that, you know, as well as a great player, he was this, you know, formidable character, somebody who again a great leader, would do anything for anybody. He recalled this time when you know, they got back to the training ground Milanello late after a Sunday game, and they had this sort of ritiro where they were staying there all week until they had a champion, a European game, the UEFA Cup game in the midweek, and he said everything was shut when they got there, and Di Bartolomei just sort of went to the kitchen and just cooked away and cooked an enormous meal for everybody, and he said that was one of his abiding memories of him as just this guy who would always come up with the goods. We just always help people out and deliver in that way, as well as on the pitch.
Yeah, funny, from your entire piece, I don't know, maybe the act of cooking a meal for somebody is a very warm and generous thing to do, and also the pragmatism that Milanello was closed and he just rolled up his sleeves and said, well, I'll sort it out, and cooked everyone a meal.
Yeah,
it's exactly. It's the most striking thing for me from the piece.
Italian footballers probably had better culinary skills than the most of their English counterparts, but it's still quite an undertaking, I think. To cook a meal at the drop of a hat for a whole squad of footballers.
Yeah, there's something lovely about it, you know, as opposed to what the hell's going on here? Why isn't the cook here? And just sorting it out. I mean, I really like this guy already, I must say. you point out that he retires in 1990 at the age of 35, as you say in the piece in the Times. Italy is obviously in the grip of World Cup fever, so it's not like the world comes to a standstill. So doing the maths here, if he committed suicide, died by suicide on May 30th, 1994, 10 years on from that night against Liverpool in the European Cup final. His retirement in 1990 means those 4 years were obviously incredibly difficult for him. It seems severe depression. Do we know, Oliver, was it linked directly to the fact that he had lost his true love in football, or was he somebody, do we know, who struggled with his mental health even whilst he was playing?
It's not really known, to be honest. I don't think anybody has suggested that they were aware of him having mental health issues when he was playing. It came out, I looked back at the Reuters reports and agency reports from the day, and it was, you know, the first one is the first report said that he'd been found dead at his home and a gunshot had been fired. The second one said that there was a quote from the police that said that, you know, we found out that he'd been having some treatment. I think it had some treatment for depression. We don't know the cause of it. And then another report the next day had a bit more information. It was talking about how he'd been frustrated and sort of felt rejected, that he'd not been able to get a way back into football. I think he'd wanted to work for Roma again, or wanted to work for Milan, or had wanted to work as a coach or as a general manager or something, and he'd just been rejected at every turn. But he'd also tried other things. He'd tried a football school business. He tried an insurance business, and both of those had sort of, belly up would be too excessive a way of putting it, but they hadn't worked out, and I think he closed both of those businesses down soon before. But I don't think anybody knows the true reason, really. And I suppose, I mean, we're probably moving on to this, but I tried to contact his son Luca, who had written a piece in the foreword to a biography of him, which is written in Italy, and he was sort of saying things like, you know, please, you know, whatever you were thinking that morning, please don't let it be because of football. Please don't let it be because because of this match 10 years earlier. You know, why was it? You know, why was it, Papa? Why was it? It's heartbreaking reading this. You sort of seeing, you know, the son is sort of writing it as his 11-year-old self, really, and it's heartbreaking. But I mean, I wasn't able to contact him in terms of getting his perspective for the story. But it's I think that probably gives a good an insight as any, really, and it tells you that, you know, there's still a sense of unknown from the family's point of view.
Right, okay, yeah, because Di Bartolomei, he left a note to his wife and children, two children, telling them he felt he was trapped in a dark hole. And, I mean, what a terrible plight for anyone to find themselves in, and for him to feel it was that inescapable is a terrible thing. You've pretty much answered the next question, and I presume the question that everyone has about him. It feels like too much of a coincidence that he does it on the 10-year anniversary of that European Cup final loss to Liverpool. And maybe it's a dreadful coincidence that the family now have to live with and mull over and try and parse their way through, but it is an extraordinary coincidence. I presume people are wary of putting forward any theories. The obvious simple one you could say is, well, this haunted him to his dying day, but who knows, and mental health is so complex.
Yeah, and often I don't think that, you know, the sort of logic that might apply in other parts of life, you know, I think often that there isn't that logic. People don't think logically in that situation. I'm guessing here, speculating here, and I shouldn't do that. So, but it does seem like it would be just the most almighty coincidence if it was a pure coincidence that 10 years to the day. I mean, I'm just looking at it now. His son's line was, "I'm always told you couldn't really have thought about it. There'll be too much malice in that coincidence. Perhaps it just crept into you on that date, because I never believed, I don't want to believe that in that moment you thought about defeat in that stupid football game. Next to the greatness of human life, next to the love of a wife and two children, what was that stupid football match?" And, I kind of want to believe Lucas' version, really, but the coincidence does seem overwhelming, and you don't want to speculate about the reasons because we just don't know. But it's just heartbreaking. And one of the guys I spoke to who had written a book on him, he said, we can't say for certain, but for someone who played in the European Cup final, the horizon sadly became too narrow. Loneliness, defeat on the field and in life, it had begun 10 years earlier. And that's... it's just tragic, really. I mean, it's not like he had missed his penalty and been vilified or anything like that. You know, he had converted his penalty brilliantly, and others had missed theirs, and there had never really been any suggestion that he was struggling to deal with the aftermath of the final. But I think it was more the struggle post football. And that maybe those regrets that were coming to a head around that anniversary, maybe it was a reminder of everything that he'd lost. But just tragic. I've got a lump in my throat talking about it.
Yeah, it's dreadfully sad. The life and times of Agostino di Bartolomei. So Oliver Kay, chief football correspondent with The Times. People can read your piece in The Times if they want to find out a bit more about him. Thanks so much, Oliver.
It's a real pleasure. Thank you.
Hey, hope you enjoyed that latest offering from Off The Ball. If you want to subscribe, and you should, check out just up here. All our latest stuff is just down here. Generally, knock yourself out.